I'd like to start session three. At session three, we like to talk about the so-called navigation in a global economy. So then we have four very excellent panelists, and I'd like to have the from the each panelist's each presentation about the global economy. Then I'd like to have the such a presentation one by one. First presentation will be done by Mr. Sumi-san. Sumi-san is director of the IMF, in charge of the regional office for the Asia and Pacific. Then I'd like to have such a presentation. Sumi-san, please.
Thank you. Hello?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Takita, for the kind introduction. So please bear with me. You have I prepare the slides. I sort of go through it in 20 minutes, so it's going to be, my job is kind of easy it is today, because I have the US, China, and Japan specialists, so I'll just talk about the world and the rest of the world, other than this big three. Now the IMF, you must have heard about the World Economic Outlook, right? And then we say like that the world is going to grow like 3.7% in 2018, and gradually picking up from the current 3.6%. Now, but then the first I'd like to show you the basic assumptions of that the projections, because that our projection is as good as our assumptions, and then we have to be very frank and say in saying that we don't have any data, have any sort of information private only to us. So we have made the big two big assumptions for this gradual recovery of the world growth is based on this gradual monetary policy normalization. Perhaps my colleague will have somewhat of deeper information about this, but we just envisage that the slow and gradual the so-called normalization of the monetary policy, notably in the US and with a spillover effect to the rest of the world. The other big assumption, not big, but then it's an assumption, is that moderate inflation and then basically commodity price stays pretty much where it is. It has, after having plummeted a few years earlier, that has come back to the current level and keeping a bit of the stability there. So that's our assumption on the basis of projection here. Now, as a world as a whole, that's a blue line, you see that we see that the bottoming out in 2016 and then coming up in 2017. Now, bad news is that this is not our first year that we said that the world will grow faster next year. So we have been saying that for several years. But the good news is that 11 months into 2017, this seems to be the right prediction for the first time in long 5 years or 6 years. So we see the gradual pickup of the global economy toward 2017 and 18. But of course, this has a wide, this is the main point, it's like a 3.7%, as I say. But as you see this fun chart, that's depending upon the assumptions, that result can vary. Now, okay. Now this is a real GDP growth. Now that China is we envisage something like a 6. For China, we envisage the 6.8% now, and then it's gradually in 2018 slows down to 6.5%. But it's also another assumption of ours. I say the China has the means to keep the growth high, if they so choose. So this is more or less like if they, you know, our recommended course of action is do the adjustment earlier on, even though it has entailed certain, you know, adjustment cost. But we are fully aware that the Chinese leadership is bound by this doubling the GDP by 2020. So that they are not going to let that growth slip lower than this number. But our policy recommendation, by the way, when we do make present policy recommendation, we do it in a very transparent way. So our so-called Article 4 consultation papers or staff reports are available in the IMF's website. But that's according to that the policy advice, we advise that China to engage upon this adjustment a bit earlier than they are envisaging at the moment, or even though that entails a bit of slower growth. But it seems like the Chinese are going ahead with a bit stimulus and then keeping the thing as it is pretty much for the time being. And that's according to that projection, we have revised up our growth forecast for China. Now, ASEAN is following around 5% growth, which, and then, you know, if you just look at this Asia as a whole, Asia has been the growth engine for the world. In 2015, it accounted for 2/3 of world growth, and it's going to be a little bit lower this year, but still the 60%, more than 60% of growth is generated in Asia and Pacific region. And then you see that here, Russia and then commodity exporters have suffered a great deal due to this slumping commodity price. And then now in 2017 and 18, given our presumption or assumption of that the commodity, broadly stable commodity price, the economy comes back up. So that accounts for largely that increase in the global growth between 2016 and 17-18. So this is the number, but then I think you can see it in that our website from the World Economic Outlook. Now, in the interest of time, I just skipped these numbers for the major countries of the world. But since I have the U.S. and China and Japan, why don't I just talk about briefly about India? The India's slow growth in 7.1 doesn't seem like low, but it's by India standard, it's been a bit lower because of this demand. They suddenly took out of the circulation the highest two denomination of their bills. Therefore, they have suffered from the short-term consequences. But then we are envisaging that impact of that policy is the immediate impact, negative impact is short-lived, and then they are going back to the normal trajectory of like 7.5% in the later years. So this is India is definitely a bright spot in this picture. And the China, as you see, we had a little bit lower growth projection in the 2017 in earlier projections, but now we realize that the Chinese unfortunately are not listening to advice, and then they are going ahead with a bit of a stimulus and then keep the economy growing faster. So that's now we envisage that 6.8% growth for the 17. But having said that, the numbers are numbers. I mean, that numbers are subject to assumptions, and I have shown the Schwann chart. So that's not really that important thing. Our message is that, the growth, global growth picked up in 2017, and most of the advanced economies, we are observing the upswing cyclically. So that's a good thing. But then emerging market and developing economies, Now, the commodity price is bottoming out, so that's a good news for many of the emerging economy, half of which are basically the commodity exporters. But commodity importers are not doing too shabby either. Now, inflation remains subdued, and then the risks are skewed to the in the medium term to the downside. And then we look at this when we make the presentation to the country authorities after we visit each country, the tendencies of our policy advice is like take this great opportunity to do that fiscal and other structural reform. To borrow Madame Lagarde's word, let's try to fix the roof when the sun is shining. So that's exactly what our current situation is. We envisage a very stable outlook for the future, and then now it's a good time to think about the structural reform to tackle this downside risks in the medium terms. So this is basically the run-up of what I have said, that advanced economies cyclically rebound, but they are still, some countries more than others, still have lingering effect of the structural sort of, whenever the bubble burst, we look at how stupid we were to have the bubble in the first place, right? But our experience shows that bubble fed in the during the years that previous bubble have collapsed. So when the one bubble collapses or implodes, then we put a lot of things into the economy to keep that economy afloat. That will sort of grow, let another bubble grow. So we are in the process of that having coped with the first bubble implosion in like 2009. Now we have the Fed have loosened the monetary policy, so did BOJ, so did ECB, so plenty of liquidity there. Now we are trying to wind up so that we don't see the next big bubble burst. So that's a situation where we are, and then we are looking at the economies, authorities to take actions to do the needed structural reform. And then what is the biggest challenges we have is basically the demographic headwinds. The Europe and then Japan and then China has entered the era when that the growth of like a prime age population, 15 to 65, has already begun to shrink or is about to start shrinking. So this is the demographic is going to be the drag on the economy in the medium term, except for a few Asian countries like India, Indonesia, Philippines, all have a young and growing population. But other than that, we generally have that demographic headwind. Now let me turn to Asia. Again, Asia is in a favorable position. Growth is revised up, but again, the sustainability is not clear. See that, again, look at China. Now, we see the obvious need for Chinese rebalancing. And we see that very rapid the credit growth of China, which will need to be rectified in some way or the other. But then how they do it depends quite critically. And then I have I'll stop here. We have a Chinese expert here, but that's a basic assumption. That's a big uncertainty we envisage. Again, like I said, that contribution to global growth, Asia has contributed very strongly, but then it's going to decline, which is not a bad thing. It's meaning that the rest of the world is now growing, so it's that in a sense burden is off the Asia's to be the growth center. Okay, and then one thing I like to emphasize is that when you talk about Asia, you think about Asia has grown by exporting. Right? It's certainly true that the export sector is very important in many of the Asian countries. But look at that net exports contribution to growth. Like this is this blue here. So many countries, Asia as a whole, net exports contributes almost negligibly, or sometimes mostly like negatively to Asia's growth in general. Even for China, like of course they do export quite a lot, but they do import quite a lot too. So in terms of the net exports, it's a contribution to growth. Asia's growth is not export-led, as many people seem to still consider. It's the same thing. The Japan has 2016 and 17, that's been positive, but then we're envisaging, again, that the negative contribution from net exports in Korea, ASEAN, the whole too. Okay, again, I'm not downplaying the importance of the export sector, because it can export, then they can import. So that's an important sector, but in terms of the net export, that's their contribution to growth has been small, and it's getting smaller. And then they are doing quite, in terms of looking at the current account balances, you see that if you, within the column, if you go to the right, that's more recent. And then the Japan's current account balance is mostly like their earnings from their big holding of overseas assets. So in terms of trade asset, Japan is barely breaking even. So again, this balancing, we are seeing that a bit of a rebalancing or small shrinking current account balances across Asia. And total portfolio flows. You know, first we were a bit afraid that in the era of a very easy money, that Asia has been the destination of many of the global liquidity. So investors looked at the search for yield, and then they thought that Asia has been a relatively safe place to put their money in. So in the time when the monetary condition was very easy across the globe, then Asia had received quite a lot of inflow. But as the cycle had changed, financial cycle changed, and then Fed started tightening, going back to normalcy a little bit, then we thought that we may see quite a lot of reversal of that capital flow that takes the capital quite a lot away from Asia. But so far, that hasn't happened yet. So you see that the emerging Asia, this green bar, it's still on the upside. Its portfolio flows has been still positive for Asia. But then there is a risk that we will see. We have seen the glimpse of it when that the taper tantrum in 2000 was like 13, when that Indonesia, India, had seen that quite a bit of capital outflow, and it brought about a bit of confusion in the financial markets. But then, so we've been cautiously looking at things, but then so far we are seeing a bit of not so much of capital flight out of this region. Well, inflation subdued. I mean, what more can I say? It's not really that a big issue now. Let me skip this. So let me go to the downside risks. The first, of course, as the Asia has been the recipient of so much capital flow during the super easy monetary flow, money condition era, now we have to think about the reversal, possible reversal of it. And then during the very easy money period, the many of the Asian firms have started to borrow quite a lot. Again, that the money bond issue was quite large, and the corporate leverage has gone up quite a bit. So we have encouraged the national authorities in the region to look very closely at the sort of individual cooperation basis, because the aggregate doesn't matter when it comes to this, because when company A is borrowing and is going to suffer quite a lot when the economic condition turns, and company B is very sound, but company B is not going to pay for the company A. So even though the average is manageable, that what is important is the distribution of that leverage, and then especially the foreign currency denominated external debt. So that's the first behind that the rationale behind the first one. And go by little in the following slides. Now, credit gap we define credit gap as a sort of a difference of the credit growth from their historical trend. Now, emerging Asia, as you look at this green line, this in the since the aftermath of this the global financial crisis, again, rest of the world was regarded not creditworthy for their money. So many of the global investors looked at the Asia as their destination for investment. So they have got quite a lot of capital flow, and then credit have grown within each country. So we have seen quite a bit of a surge in this green line. Okay, so now China is one of that the big recipient, and then the, also China is the has we have observed a very rapid credit growth in China, and then this is the. Well, again, this is the kind of chart that we show to the authorities that now this is a baseline. Now you go proactive measures, then your growth may suffer a little bit than this baseline, but eventually it comes back. You will be coming up better than the what you are continuing to do. So, but this is we do of course make it out of very sophisticated. The calculation, but the message is simple. So bite the bullet now and you'll be better off, and then if you continue doing it, you'll be worse off. That's basically what our sort of message is. Now, I talked about credit growth and the credit gap. So if you look at that country by country, this is Hong Kong, this is China, this is Singapore. So this is the actual credit growth, and this is a trend. Again, China likewise, and Singapore. So you see that Hong Kong, China, Singapore, all we have seen that the higher credit growth than their historical trends. And last time, when we had this large credit gap across many of our region, that was in 2015, 16, 18, and then we all know what happened in 1997, right? So that was a bit ominous that we had this credit gap up to this Asian financial crisis, and then we see these credit gaps across the mostly Chinese-speaking world in Asia. So that's one reason that we can't be complacent at the good growth prospects. But we have shown this, of course, to the national authorities, and the national authorities have recognized this, and they are taking measures to counter this. So unlike in the 1997, when it came as a surprise, the authorities are pretty much prepared and know about this, and then taking good measures about this. Now, in the interest of time, let me highlight a little bit on the same topic. I talked about the corporate leverage has gone up in Asia. So did the household credit. And if you look at this tooth on the red bar, across the board, you see that the red bar is taller than the gray bar. So during this 20 years, the household have accumulated quite a bit of debt. I mean, during which time the GDP has grown too, but this is a percent of GDP. So in terms of absolute number, household in these countries, especially Australia, Korea, New Zealand, and Thailand. These countries have accumulated quite a lot of, households have accumulated quite a bit of debt during this two decades, after this Asia financial crisis. So this is the reason that we urge the authorities to look to become quite vigilant about. As you see, another way of looking at this is the private sector debt is growing. On the other hand, in general terms, that Asia countries have been quite managing their fiscal all right, so that public debt to GDP hasn't grown too much during this during the years. Okay, so I've this is the sort of breakdown of the one sentence for each of the countries. But again, the China, Japan, and will be taken up by experts. So again, I talked about this. So let me talk about, say, India. India has a corporate and banking sector strains. Their non-performing loan is quite large. And then, the authorities are not so forthcoming in tackling it in an expeditious manner. So of course, being a Japanese and knowing, I'm old enough to know that the 1990s of Japan, so the authorities' response is quite, I could understand the rationale, but then we would like to see a little bit more expeditious handling of this non-performing loans. And then Korea problem is not that different from the many other advanced part of Asia. Across the globe, we see that this productivity growth has slowed, and we see that the challenges to revive it. We all know that every year our iPhones, your Android phone, Samsung, becomes faster and you take a better picture. But then productivity wise, despite all this technological advancement, what we do with this technological advancement has not caught up yet. So we have seen a bit of, stalling the productivity growth. I've written this as the Korea's problem, but it's not a Korea-specific problem. We are going to renew this productivity growth. Okay, and then ASEAN, if you look at this, I wrote it here, infrastructure gaps. Now, after the, say, Asian financial crisis, which was a very bitter memory for many of the Asia authorities, they took a very cautious monetary and fiscal policy. So they did very cautious, prudently on fiscal. But that has resulted in the lack of or shortage of the needed infrastructure investment. So we have now have a situation where the IMF, you may think the IMF to say the tighten the belt, laying in the expenditures, but actually we are encouraging the authorities to expand the infrastructure investment. That the kind of infrastructure investment that would crowd in or make the private sector business environment better, so that the private sector can increase investment. For example, if you have access road to the market, then the private sector can build manufacturing facilities or plants there. So we need more infrastructure investment that will sort of encourage the private sector investment that creates jobs. Okay, I'm running out of my 20 minutes, so I'm willing to answer questions, but then this is basically what our message is. Again, let me emphasize here, it's infrastructure. Singapore is a bit of an exception, but if you look at these places, despite the strong growth potentials, they are now suffering suffering from the strains on the supply side, and their GDP cannot grow beyond their sustainably beyond their potential growth, and that the supply side is being strained by the lack of infrastructure. So we encourage the infrastructure investment to increase the potential growth. Right, I stop here, and thank you very much.
Thank you for Mr. Sumi-san. So I enjoyed the round the globe trip for your explanation. Thank you. Then I'd like to concentrate in the United States economy. Then we have the next excellent presenters, Mr. William Strauss. He is a senior economist for the Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago. Please.
You. Thank you very much, and thank you very much for the invitation to join you today to talk briefly about where I see and the official forecast from the Federal Market Committee see the economy moving over the next year or so. So in general, the U.S. economy, which entered the ninth year of its expansion in the middle of this year, is growing at a reasonable rate. We're looking at growth on a year-over-year basis of 2.3%. This is slightly above what is regarded as the trend growth for the U.S. economy, which is around 1.8 to 2%. And that's, of course, driven by the labor force growth, productivity growth. So we're doing a bit better than that, but not substantially. And after Sumi-san shared with you what we're seeing around the world, it's a kind of a similar pattern, where we're just seeing okay growth, decent growth, but not impressive growth, both in the U.S. and many parts of the world. In fact, when we look at the growth since the middle of 2009, this has been the weakest expansion that we have seen in the U.S. economy since the Great Depression, a growth rate that has averaged just 2.2%, barely over trend growth. And that is why, even in the ninth year of the expansion, on the real side of the U.S. economy, we see slack that continues to occur. I'll give some examples of those. Before I do that, let me just, so some people might have been getting excited about the fact that U.S. economy in the last couple of quarters had superior growth of close to 3% or slightly above that. And is this the new growth rate that the current administration keeps talking about? I think that we have to be very cautious about that. In fact, one of my favorite indicators to look at the underlying pattern for the U.S. economy is something that we produce at the Chicago Fed, which is known as the National Activity Index. And the way to interpret this is when the indicator is at this black line, it means that the growth of the economy is roughly at a trend rate of growth. If it goes above, we're doing better than trend. If it goes below, we're not meeting expectations of what the economy should do. And if it gets down too low, typically a minus 0.7 to a minus 1.3, that's an area where you have to worry about the economy's growth actually becoming negative, in other words, a recession. So the good news is that we are far from worrying about a recession. But on the other hand, data that we have in hand through September illustrates that we are not seeing activity that is in that range of superior growth. It is still this kind of trend-like growth that we have witnessed over the past 8-plus years. There are positive signs out there. Certainly, you look at what's happening with the stock market. And the way we think about the stock market is in large part the wealth effect. People are looking at their balances. They're feeling better. We generally think maybe 2, possibly 3% of capital gains that occur might translate into additional spending. So that, again, is a helpful part of what we think going forward. So what is the thought going forward? Well, as many of you are aware, while the Fed meets at least 8 times a year for the Federal Market Committee, 4 times a year, they offer up what is known as a Summary of Economic Projections, the SEP. Most recent one is the one that occurred in September. And in September, the Fed was forecasting that we're going to see growth come in this year at this roughly 2.3%. That's the red diamond is the median value of the Fed policymakers. That's, in fact, fact, a bit improved from their view in June. So even with the hurricanes that came through Texas and parts of the southern United States and Florida, in fact, it's viewed as having some positive stimulus for replacement demand, as well as repairs and so forth that need to take place, that will boost the economy to some degree this year. It's temporary, because as you can see, the expectation for next year and for the next several years is that growth remains decent, but not impressive. That in fact we get growth that kind of slows and moves into that blue shaded area, which is that trend rate of performance for the U.S. economy. Nonetheless, if we reach the middle of 2019 and the economy is still growing, which we certainly are forecasting and expected to grow, we will now set a record for U.S. economic expansion, exceeding the previous record, which is actually illustrated up here, of 120 consecutive months of growth. Is that possible? I actually think there's a greater chance of that occurring, in part because this moderate growth rate that we have been seeing now for over 8 years has led to little concerns about imbalances, in particular, and especially on the real side of the economy. So corrections to adjust probably do not need to take place. In fact, I'll give you a couple of things that I look at to think about these risks to recession. One of them is the survey of professional forecasters. And in fact, following the election of President Trump, in fact, this indicator moved actually a bit lower. So all in all, these forecasters are suggesting that a risk of recession has gone down over the past year, probably thinking that we will get some positive fiscal stimulus at some point, whether it's tax reform. We're already seeing some pulling back on some of the regulatory burdens that were put on businesses. And then when we look at how the labor market is doing, it's actually been an exceptional performance. This does not include, this is only taking us up through the third quarter, it does not include the October number, which actually had a bit of a bounce back following the hurricane-affected month of September. And in fact, we have added 2 million jobs over the past 12 months. This is about double what the U.S. should be adding, given the demographics of our labor force growth, which is well under 1%. As you can see, we've been adding at a rate that is well over 1%. So this cannot continue forever, but nonetheless, continues to add a lot of jobs for workers out there, and that has, again, added to purchasing power by individuals. The unemployment rate has reached a level of 4.1%. All in all, a very, very low level. This is showing up through September. Again, October, it ticked down by a tenth of a percent. But as mentioned earlier, we're just beginning to see some of the signs of the costs of employees moving higher. We're seeing both wages in green, benefits in red, are both beginning to move higher, but they're not escalating very rapidly. And there's two things we need to keep in mind. Number one, this particular measurement does not take into account inflation. So we're barely over 2% at this point in time. If you take out 1.5% of inflation at this, let's call it, we're still looking at real wage gains that are less than 1%. And as you can see, it has been like that for a very long period of time. And I think that's a bit of what has underlied frustration among American workers that probably played a role with regard to the election cycle. So the question is this going to translate into higher prices for goods? Not necessarily, especially if productivity begins to come back. I'll talk more about productivity in just a minute. But when we look at the forecast for the unemployment rate by the Fed believes that the natural rate of unemployment is between 4.5% and 4.7%, 4.8%. So 4.5, 4.75%, basically. We're expecting to see the unemployment rate remain below that for some period of time. I think in part, as we'll see with the forecast for inflation, the Fed is not anticipating inflation ticking up very much. Certainly our president of the Chicago Fed, Charlie Evans, agrees with President Harker, we heard from this morning, that the inflation inbound target of 2% is not a ceiling, but something that we should be averaging around. Therefore, I look at this expectation of the unemployment rate remaining below the natural rate as an indicator that the Fed is willing to accept what would be regarded as a somewhat hotter labor market for some time to go, all the way into 2020. Productivity. I think this has been the most disappointing aspect of the U.S. economy is the fact that productivity growth has gone down quite a bit. This is a five-year moving average. Productivity performance in the past year has done better, but I think I like the five-year moving average as a way of just illustrating what the economy has been dealing with now for quite a period of time. And as Sumi-san suggested, we're seeing this not just in the U.S., but in many other parts of the world. And I think this is a big part of an explanation of why we're not seeing the wage gains that we would expect, because ultimately you can pay workers what they deliver in terms of productivity. And I think it also squares the circle of what's going on with regard to the investment cycle, because when you're looking at how do you grow an economy, you have those two options. You could add workers, and workers in the U.S. have been plentiful. They've not been very expensive. And therefore, because of the flexible labor markets, firms, if they go into a risky downturn, can shed workers and shed their costs. Whereas if you buy a piece of capital, you will be stuck making payments on that, even though they sit idle. And as we also heard, technology is making capital investments depreciate ever more quickly. And in fact, when we look at what has gone on with investment, I think we can see one of the main reasons why productivity growth has slowed. You can see that the blue line here, the year-over-year investment in the United States for real investment, actually turned negative last year. As many of you are aware, investment doesn't go negative during an expansion period. You can see it goes negative during recessions when capital becomes, you know, available and you're not about to buy a new piece of equipment when you have equipment sitting idle. So investment suffers during a downturn, but not during an expansion. Yet this time we saw that. Why? Again, I think it was the fact that workers were replacing that investment demand. But investment hasn't taken place for a long enough period of time that and workers are finally seeing their wages go up, their costs of and as well as the availability of the really skilled workers that you're looking for. It is truly getting harder to find some of those. So I think we are in the ninth inning of the labor market finally being normalized. And I think manufacturers and other businesses are seeing that and are finally, as you can see here, we've had now three good quarters of investment this year. And I think we're about to see an investment cycle that's going to make up for this ill amount of investment for many years. And I think that investment cycle is going to improve workers' productivity and therefore will probably in some degree offset some of the wage and benefit gains that we're seeing, and that it might not necessarily translate into inflation. Well, certainly, we'll be watching that. As President Harker suggested this morning, it's something that we would be very concerned about if it starts to get a bit out of hand. And when we look at inflation, as mentioned, it had gotten up to our 2% target earlier this year, weakened in part because of the movement of energy prices, but as you can see, it recently began to move higher. We'll have to keep an eye on that and hopefully get closer to our target, which is 2% for the policy. It's expected not to reach it this year, but we're, is expected to achieve that by next year. And importantly, the FOMC is thinking that this inflation rate does not go above 2%, both in 2019 nor in 2020. Again, if it happens to go above that, I think I could speak for our president of the Chicago Fed. If it just happens to, you know, go at 2.1, 2.2, even 2.3, with no sense of acceleration above that, we would be willing to probably accept that. Industrial production is showing improvement finally after seeing little growth over the last couple of years. The weakening of the U.S. dollar has been helpful to some degree this year. It had strengthened by, in real terms, over 20%, and that made U.S. goods relatively more expensive to foreign consumers and foreign goods relatively less expensive to domestic consumers in the United States. So that really hurt our manufacturing, but is expected to come back and perform well. Trend growth is something just under 3%. We get that this year, in fact, a little bit softer next year, but growth nonetheless, but not impressive growth. Another example of slack in the economy is the fact that our housing market, which of course was one of the leading culprits for the collapse of the economy back in 2007-2009, is the fact that it's coming back, but the forecast from the Blue Chip Forecast Group is of 1.3 million housing starts next year. That is still below what we think of as the rate that we should be adding given demographics of household formation, which is around 1.4 to 1.5 million. So even this sector, 10 years into its correction, is still not back to normal even next year. I talked about the forecast that comes from the Survey of Professional Forecasters for risk of recession. You know, people's opinions are sometimes worth what you pay for it. That's why I often like markets as a complement to that, to look at what the markets are thinking about risk of recession. So here I'm looking at the credit spread between high-risk borrowers, people from the high-yield side, subtracting from that the corporate AAA. And when you begin to get worried about a recession, you of course worry about the high risky borrowers paying you back. So this indicator tends to rise during these periods of concern. As you can see, this has been moving down since the early part of 2016, kind of bottomed earlier this year, and has remained all in all quite flat. This is a daily rate, good as of, I think with this presentation that I sent within the last week and a half. Again, we're not seeing any signs of this ticking up. So these individuals who are making bets with their dollars are suggesting to me that, again, very little risk for a recession in the United States. Another thing you could often look at, I know this is one of Michael Drury's favorite things to think about, is the flattening of the yield curve. And here I'm just doing a very simple, taking the 10-year Treasury note versus the 3-month Treasury bill. And you can see that when it goes negative, in other words, when the short rates get higher than the longer rates, shortly after that, we get a recessionary period. We are still, while things have flattened, we still have over a percent before we would need to worry about inversion. Again, something that we watch, but so far, I don't think it's even worth even raising up. Maybe a yellow flag comes up a little bit, but again, certainly not a red flag by any means. So just to close off, Fed policy. You know, we heard from President Harker this morning with regard to policy recommendations that he would like to think about. Right now, the Fed has brought up interest rates by just 1% since the middle of, or since the end of 2015. So we are about to approach, in a few weeks, 2 years where it has just moved up by 1%. So this is a very, very slow removal of the accommodative policy. We are not putting the brakes on the U.S. economy. We're just taking our foot off the gas pedal. And it's really not until we go above the neutral stance of monetary policy that we should really even be thinking about slowing the economy in terms of a braking action. And in fact, looking at the summary of economic projections, the current thinking at the Fed is that you know, something around 2.5 to 3% is what is regarded as the neutral rate for monetary policy. We will get to that sometime in 2019, and we will more than likely not get above it, maybe get towards the upper end of what some people would regard as a neutral stance, but not exceed it even by 2020. So with all in all, the Fed is still accommodative through this forecast of 2020, but the accommodation is being removed, and again, by roughly 2019. COVID-19, we're kind of neither helping the economy nor hindering the economy from its underlying growth path. But as President Harker mentioned, even though we did not make a change in interest rates at the last meeting, we did announce that beginning in October of this year, we are beginning to very slowly remove some of the purchases that we make on our balance sheet. Beginning this quarter, each month, we're removing $10 billion worth. That'll increase to $20 billion next quarter, $30 billion the quarter after that, $40 billion in the third quarter of next year, and finally, $50 billion in the final quarter of next year. So we will begin to see more material observations of this very high balance sheet that we have added since the Great Recession begin to come down. And again, we're doing this in a very cautious approach to make sure of, the, as we talked about this morning, taper tantrums and so forth. I think so far the reaction is that the market is understanding what's going on, and so far, I would say, so good. But we'll be monitoring it as we move forward. So summary points, kind of more the same. You know, it's going to be decent but not impressive growth. The slack in the economy is continuing to be worked out. And while we probably still next year have slack in certain parts of the economy, such as the manufacturing sector, such as the housing sector, the labor market will probably be closer to normal, and other parts of the economy closer to normal. But again, no part that seems to be getting overheated that we need to worry about causing some disruption within the United States. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Then next presenter is Mr. Mikhail Drury. He is chief economist of McVean Trading and Investment Limited, LLC. Please present about mainly China, Chinese economy, please.
So I'm going to quickly go through politics, short run and long run in China. I can do that quickly because politics is all important, but it's all Xi. Short-term economics is easy. The Chinese make up their numbers, so you can't tell if I'm wrong or not. And long run, I won't be here for you to find out, so I can be really quick about the presentation. I always put this chart up first. China's currently an $11.8 trillion economy, actually in the third quarter in dollar denominated. It's $12.4 trillion. It's currently 68% of the size of the United States economy. And it's a much bigger contributor to the goods side of the world economy than the United States is. The big question in China is what happened in the leadership shuffle. Everybody got all excited about who was going to be elevated onto the standing committee, the seven men that run China. That was not the interesting part of the deal. The interesting part of the deal is that of the 31 provincial governors and 31 party bosses, all but five of them have already been elevated by Xi, most of them in the last 2 years. Now, these are the guys who are going to make up future Politburos, future standing committees, and basically all of them owe their allegiance to Xi at this point. In the standing committee, the people who were elevated, the big issue was always we knew that the two top guys were going to stay. The big question was number three, Wang, who ran the corruption campaign. He was 69 years old. Was he going to be allowed to stay, which some would interpret as a sign that Xi was going to remain in power forever and ever and ever, that he was going to basically what I call pull a Putin, that he would never leave office. Wang stepped down, and from my understanding was for personal reasons, he no longer wanted to be in that position. But more importantly, he promoted everybody from the corruption campaign into better positions. So he's still going to be the puppet master, you know, determining what happens to people's careers for a very long time. The five men who were elevated from the Politburo to the Standing Committee are all known commodities. Everybody's aware of who they are. They've had these positions in the Politburo for a long time. Everybody predicted that four of those five were going to be promoted pretty much, so there were no real surprises there. The surprise was that the two fellows in yellow at the bottom, who represent the next generation of Chinese leaders, neither one of them was promoted onto the seven-man Politburo, and they didn't expand the Standing Committee to nine to have a next generation leader. Again, a lot of people seem to think that this means she is going to stay forever. I think the reality is she had such a good time at the party elevations that it tells you that he's not going to stay forever. Not only were there 11 people who were retired by the 67-year automatic retirement age, another three people who were under the age of 67, two of whom were China Youth League, which is a party within a party that she is not particularly in favor of, two of them were forced to resign, as well as one of Xi's allies, and then a fourth gentleman who had been a next generation leader was expelled from the party only 3 weeks before the 19th Congress was convened, and it was done in a very vocal, very public way in order to deliver a message that no one is safe from the corruption campaign. So with 15 positions available, two of the positions on the Politburo always go to the military. One was open. She promoted one of his best friends into that position. There are always three vice premiers. She promoted two people into those positions, both from the state council. And he promoted Hu Chunhua, who was one of those next generation leaders from Guangdong province. Basically, he promoted him up and out. Basically promoted him into a position where he'll have very little power going forward. There are five members of the General Secretariat. Think of that as the cabinet, the go-between the party and the state, the actual government positions. She took all five of those five. Now, what's important about that is that he had all five of those five in deputy positions already, which means this isn't something he thought up this week or this year or in the last 2 years. This has been planned for 3 or 4 or 5 years. Provincial leaders, he took five of the six. So basically, of the 15 positions that can be promoted, she took 13 of them. That's pretty much a clean sweep. That pretty much means that the future of China is Xi's vision of the future of China, and that is a China which is the party first, and we'll talk about that a bit later. So where is China right now? Think of the Chinese economy as a roller coaster that has a 3-year economic cycle that goes from low points of 3% to high points of 9%. Oh, but wait a minute, you're telling me 3 and 9, the Chinese government always announces 6.7%. That's because if the party were to tell you that the change in growth was any different than that way, what they said it was, that would mean that the market, not the party, set growth in China. And that's simply an unacceptable concept to the statistical board in China. The reality is they move on a boom-bust cycle. They're on their way down on that roller coaster, and the leading car of the roller coaster, this is done based on real estate. Real estate in the 17 big cities has been negative the last 2 months in a row. Now, why does it move on a boom-bust cycle? Because of credit. Credit booms, then it sloughs off. It booms, then it sloughs off. The first boom was after Lehman. The second boom was in 2012 to guarantee that who and when the old leaders of China left on a high note. And now we've had this extended rise in credit, basically starting in 2015, which is a correction of the corruption campaign, which caused a global recession in 2015. Bill Strauss was talking about negative investment in the United States in 2015, which doesn't happen except in a recession. Well, there was a recession in 2015, but it was global. It didn't happen in the United States because it happened in their currencies. Almost everybody in the world devalued between 15 and 25% to get their labor back competitive in dollars with demand from the United States. The main thing that I look at to tell me where the Chinese think the Chinese economy is their currency. Early on, you can see that it was rising very rapidly right in here. This is the Lehman period where it goes flat, then it starts to rise. This is the beginning of the corruption campaign in 2014. This is the one-time devaluation that everybody said, oh my God, China's blowing up, the world's coming to an end. It was the beginning of a very, you know, expected trend for them, where they allowed their currency to weaken to take themselves out of the recession that they themselves had started in 2014. And here at the beginning of 2016, we see that turning around. Why is that important? Because that chart, dollar-denominated GDP in China, is the commodities market. You can do that same chart from 1970 to 1990 in yen for Japan, and it's the commodities market. That's because dollar-denominated demand from the fastest-growing economy on the planet determines what's happening to commodities prices. That's the price of corn and copper. They both explode in 05 through the Lehman period. They crash in Lehman. They rebound very quickly because China had a massive stimulus in 2008. They peak. Every commodity in the world peaked on March 11th, 2011. Anybody in the room know what that date is? The tsunami. The tsunami broke supply chains all across Asia, and then the Thai floods right behind it, and that allowed all of the supply that had been called out by these higher prices to finally catch up with demand. And every commodity price on the planet has been falling ever since, until we get this uptick in Chinese currency, which tells you that their buying power is escalating very, very rapidly. We see it in copper, not so much in corn there. This is oil. Oil on that chart, it's at 55. It's actually trading at 64 this morning. So we're starting to see it feed through into oil as well. The other reason that the Chinese are keeping their currency strong is that they like to keep their foreign exchange reserves in line with their underlying imports. They allowed it to fall. They allowed their FX to fall when their dollar-denominated imports were falling. But now that they've turned around, they need to keep FX back in the country. To do that, they strengthen their currency so that there's no advantage in putting your funds out in dollars or in any other currency. You'd rather be in yen, which are appreciating against every currency. So where is China? You see back here, they bottomed in the middle of 2015, they grew, and now it's not really clear if they're going sideways or in services if they're going down. But what's important about that is that they bottomed here in the middle of 2015. That's the United States coming out of their recession, which wasn't a recession. This is England coming out of theirs. This is Japan coming out of theirs. In the absence of monetary and policy stimulus in Japan, Europe, and the United States, it is monetary and fiscal policy stimulus in China which calls the global economy tune. And that tune was for growth from here in 2015, which is now booming everywhere and everybody's excited, except I'm telling you China's already slowing down. Why do I think China's slowing down? Well, these are their reported GDP numbers. These are the lies. So there's a very strong correlation between PPI and the deflator, but it's broken recently. They're lying by about 2%. Their growth is 2% stronger than they say it is. There's a strong relationship between real GDP leading prices, which makes sense to everybody who's ever run an econometric model, except prices are going up now with no increase in output. That makes no sense at all. So the Chinese are lying to the tune of 3, 4, maybe 5% on their nominal GDP growth. And that's why commodities have been outperforming even the numbers that I showed you. But where are we now? Well, they say all the growth came in primary and secondary, in other words, in manufacturing and mining, and no growth came in services. That makes no sense at all. So we know they're lying. What do the numbers tell us? Well, this is the Li Ka-shing Index, rail traffic and electricity production. It tells you that you came to a peak here at the beginning of the year, and now you're starting to head down on both of them. That's corroborated by what we know about trade, which is not only the Chinese reported data, but we get this data from Korea, Japan, all the other Asian countries, and it all tells us that these numbers are coming down. The actual numbers are down here now at almost zero based on the last 2 to 3 months worth of data. So what's the long run for China if it's slowing down? Why is it slowing down? Well, the assumption on Wall Street is that, the assumption on Wall Street is that Xi Jinping, now that he has taken control of all of the power reins in China, would do what they'd do, which is that he'd go out and he'd make a more efficient economy and he'd generate more growth and he'd make more money. Xi Jinping does not have a capitalist bone in his body. He's a party man, and he believes in the party first. What he's going to do is take the power that he's consolidated and take on anybody who would be a threat to the party in the future. In the first 5 years of his reign, he took on corruption, meaning grow, grow, grow in the countryside, where all of these small provincial ministers had basically padded their own lives with capital and were just trying to grow to create jobs because they saw that as the way to promotion. And he broke that through the corruption campaign and through a failure to promote people who simply added jobs instead of quality. So the mantra now in China is quality, not quantity of life. The second thing that they're doing is the One Belt, One Road project. I alluded to this briefly in the morning. The key here is to have a land-based delivery system for everything that China produces. Not only do they have now a west coast of China out here in Xi'an, where they can deliver through Moscow into Europe, but they're trying to go down through Myanmar into the Indian Ocean so they can go around by a water route. Basically, they'll be able to deliver in 36 hours from western China, Xi'an, to Paris. Now you compare that to right now delivering from China to the United States or Japan to the United States, you're talking about 2 to 3 weeks on the water. The next thing that they're looking at is that China correlates their terrible pollution problem with climate change. Now, the key here is it does not matter whether that's true or not. It only matters that they think that it's true. The capital of China used to be out here in Xi'an at the base of the Himalaya Mountains before 1400, because the snowmelt came off the Himalayas and it created the most rich agricultural land in China. In here, where it's darker green, that flooded back then, and you could get dead really fast for being in the wrong place. The number of floods in China that have killed 50 million people is amazing. But in 1400, there was what was called the mini ice age, and the world cooled down. And as it cooled down, this Greenland here became much less flooded, much richer, and they moved to Nanjing, south capital, Beijing, north capital, and the Grand Canal in between. And that's where China exists today. If we have a 4 degree centigrade warm up, as some people have talked about, all of that dark green area goes underwater. And roughly 1/3 of the population and 1/3 of the GDP of China disappears. They're concerned about that. They actually think that that might be a problem. So they're moving very quickly to adapt every kind of green energy that we talked about earlier that they can in order to avoid that. And then finally, the last thing that they're doing is the two things that they're likely to take on in the next 5 years, having corrected the real side of their economy, the growth side of their economy over the last 5 years, the two areas that are the biggest threats to the party are finance, debt, and the technology companies. The debt is interesting because by getting rid of the China Youth League, by driving those former politicians out of government, a lot of those guys went into business. And they went into the business of asking their few friends who were still in government what part of the government fire hose of credit and growth they could stand in front of to get rich. Not just a little rich, but really, really rich. And a lot of them did. And the best business to be in China was interest rate arbitrage. And that's because nominal growth in China has been north of 10% for the last 3, 4, 5 years, which means nominal interest rates in China should be north of 10%. They're 5. So you can go to the government, borrow money at 5, lend it at 7. That guy borrows it at 7, lends it at 9. That guy borrows it at 9, lends it at 12. That guy borrows it at 12, lends it at 15. Maybe now you're starting to talk about risk. But the real point is, how do you count that debt? You might be counting the same debt 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10, 12 times. We don't know. We don't know how much debt there is in China. We just know there's a lot, and that if the dominoes start to fall, we don't know what the connectivity between the various players are. So I worry about debt in China, but I don't worry about just the level. I worry about the connectivity. The second thing they're doing is, this is their stock market. Boom, nothing, boom, nothing, boom. And now they're engineering this rise. Basically because they've gone as far as they can go in real estate, and they have to give you a new asset that you can put your wealth in China and keep it in China to keep you from trying to put it outside China. And so they're engineering these initial public offerings of the state-owned enterprises, public private partnerships, et cetera, to try to create a stock market. You know, there are numbers now saying that they currently have about a $3 trillion stock market. There are numbers saying it'll be $17 trillion by 2030, and it'll be half the stock in the world. And so if you're a stock market investor, you might have to own Chinese stock just because it's that big a part of the world. That scares the hell out of me, because I wouldn't own Chinese stock if you gave it to me. And I think they're undermining the standards of Hong Kong, so I wouldn't own A shares either, or H shares either, because I'm not sure that you can believe the credibility of the Hong Kong market. Anyway, I don't work for the Fed. I don't work for the IMF. I report to one man in Memphis, Tennessee, who likes me a lot, so I can say pretty much anything I want to, and I don't need a disclaimer. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Next presenter is Mr. Koide. He will be a very nice timekeeper. Then
time is 8 minutes behind in the schedule, so therefore I should rush. By the way, I'm a little bit scared about the provocative Michael's story. Maybe I should trim down my global focus after I heard his story. But believe me, I have known him almost 10 years, but he is almost early bird about the real situation in China. He's a very reliable economist. By the way, oops, good words. Okay. Oops. But anyway. Let me start with the GDP growth. The latest GDP number was annualized level 2.5%. Well, that was revised down from the first estimation from the 4% centered in capital expenditure, but fairly good so far. Maybe our potential growth rate in Japan is ranged from 0.5 to 1%. So therefore, in the last almost 2 years, Japanese economy is growing more than potential growth. At the end of this, at the beginning of this year, the consensus view of the Japanese real growth is around 1%, but now maybe elevated to the 1.3, 1.4%, minus 1.6%. Still, I would like to be one of the members of the British camp. And GDP gap, the left chart is talking about the demand-supply situation of capital and labor. Diffusion index means the correlation who says that we have the excess of labor minus the number of the corporation who says that we are annoyed by the shortage of numbers. So therefore, the level go down below the 0%, the corporation as a whole is annoyed by the shortage of capital or labor. If you look at this level, the current degree of the labor shortage is equal to that in the fourth quarter of 1989 in the middle of the financial bubble. And also even in the capital stock side, we have already some shortage, moderate shortage of the capital. So therefore, why don't we discuss about the sustainable inflation in the future? And right side is the estimated GDP gap by the Cabinet Office. If you look at this chart, the 2 quarters in a row, we have some modest number of the inflation gap. Then why don't you discuss about the CPI? Already this story was covered by the Mr. Nakata of BOJ in the first panel, but we are now here. Maybe we will heading toward the 1%, but the drifting down toward the 0.6% around in the next spring, as far as there is no major change to crude oil price. And divide into the two parts, the CPI. One is the goods, core goods, excluding the fresh food and services. Service drifting down, almost flattish, although there is some moderate sustainable inflation in the goods side, thanks to the reasonably priced yen and the rising the commodity price in the international markets. And then without no doubt talking about the service prices, the major factor to affect the service price is no doubt the wage. And the share of the service price in the total core CPI is more than 50%, so therefore maybe in the future, suppose if the global economy is growing about the 3.7% as Sumi-san already argued, and if there is not a destructive change as suggested by the Michael in China, just put the good side aside. Let's talk about the service side. And if we believe that the wage growth is a key factor for the sustainable growth of service prices, this is the decomposed the contribution of the Japanese nominal wage index after the 6 months moving average. We have the gradual rise of the scheduled payment. This is the base payment. This is a bonus cut, but there is some measurable uptick. And non-scheduled payment is going down partly because of the government campaign to trim down the extra hour work. But clearly, cyclically, we are now see the turning around of bottoming out of the wage growth profile. And then there's a bunch of argument why the every countries, G7 countries, are not by the too well-tamed wage growth. There's a bunch of reasons. Already some panelists touch on the bill touch on, but among others, maybe one of the major and provocative reason why we saw the very low level of wage growth here in Japan because of the compositional change. We allow the non-regular workers, or even to the manufacturing place by the deregulation by the Koizumi government. So therefore, believe or not, some of the American friends could not believe me. But if you apply the same standard, the yardstick about the non-regular workers, that is the average week hour is less than 35%. In your country, if my memory is correct, slightly below that 30%. But in my country, 38%. So therefore, in that benchmark, in my country, the non-regular workers' share in total labor force is higher, even higher than that in the United States. So therefore, I decompose the wage growth into the three parts. The wage growth of the regular workers, wage growth of the non-regular workers, and the compositional change. That means, namely, the continuous elevation of the share of the non-regular workers. If you look at this chart, since the year 2006, the major contribution pushed down the growth of the wage was a compositional change. Then I calculated the scheduled payment per capita, both in regular workers and non-regular workers, because of the tightening labor market, just I already let you show, look at. If my calculation is correct, and last year, the per capita wage growth in non-regular workers is well over the 4%. In peripheral labor market, still we have clear wage upward pressure. Then in the second panel, I remember that the Mr. Tokyo Patterson says that the, because of untapped, well-educated Japanese woman is a kind of secret army for the Japanese labor supply. But in a sense, already we have done, and still the our women worker force is still become a kind of army here. This is the labor participation rate of the female. Red one is Japan, 1990 and dotted line, and the current level is this line, thick line, and the green was the US, 1999 and 2016. Believe or not, in some age bracket, look at the age started from 45 to 54, the labor participation rate in Japan is a little bit higher than that in the United States. Of course, we have a serious structural issue to be tackled, because the share of the non-regular workers in the women is much, much higher than that in males. So therefore, we should do something about that. But if you just look at the how many percentage point of the labor force just we has been using, the women's labor participation is aggressively just becoming better. So therefore, maybe there is less elbow room for us to tap the middle-aged woman as a cheap labor force. That was one reason to push up the non-regular workers of the wage growth in the recent year. And then Philip's cup, Horizon touch on that, where this is debatable, that where there is a steel Philip's cup or not. This is a Japanese Philip's cup, started since the 1980s. We are now here, and I'm not sure whether the we will heading for some inflection point here. Someone would argue that after we got into the deflation, maybe the Philip's cup is much more flattish. I don't know, but I look at just the most serious labor shortage in my country since the late 1989, and the wage for the peripheral workforce already elevated more than 4% per capita. It's quite reasonable to argue that somewhere between where the employment rate is from 2.5 to 3%, we will see some inflection of the unit wage, and that would maybe the springtime of next year. And then Takita-san urged me to just speed up. Then suppose if there is some inflation wage, push up the CPI, including the service industries, and the people's inflation expectation will be harnessed in the household. And let's talk about a little bit about the corporate manager sentiment. In the last general snap election, one of the focal point in the policy agenda is high level of the cash equivalent asset in a Japanese corporation. This was the cash and liquid on hands, just including the short-term security divided by the sales, just elevated to the historical high since we got into the deflation. But the left chart, this is green line, is the estimated return on investment. The gap between the return on asset and the weighted average cost of capital continue to move up to the historical high. But on the other hand, the annual growth of the capital expenditure go down, slow down, the other way around. And what about the wage? Believe or not, maybe just Michael told me that this is too naive analysis, but I just tried to figure out the unit labor cost in China and Japan, just as employed data of the real output of the manufacturers, gauged by the real dollar value as in year 2005. That was disclosed by the World Bank, and divided by the total nominal wage for the manufacturing workers. When the China get into the WTO in the middle of the 1990s, Japanese unit labor cost more than double. But right now, in my calculation, the Japanese unit labor cost in manufacturing sector is 35% cheaper than that in China. So therefore, labor is cheaper, and capital is cheaper, and the expected return from the investment is high. So why don't put your cash in much more efficient way? That was the issue of the corporate governance. Then the last chart I would touch on, this is the propensity to consume of the household loan from the loan just from this 1977 most striking chart in my presentation today. This is the here we have a huge spike. This is the 1 month before the latest VAT hike, and this is the third time we had the VAT hike. There's no such spike. At that time, there's moderate inflation pressure, and still the crude oil price hovering up just above the triple digit. There is much more good cost pressure. So therefore, and also there is a rumor that maybe once the corporate managers raise the base wage, we will have a handsome amount of the bonus. So therefore, people just accelerate, front-loaded their purchase of big ticket item. But after that, there is a plummeting gasoline price associated with the very, very sluggish growth of the bonus. So therefore, people's inspiration expectation was just destroyed. But I was waiting for this kind of disruptive change in the future, non-linear change. Once the household investors, the corporate managers just harness their moderate inflation expectation and rebalancing the cash out of anywhere will boost the Japanese potential growth in the future. Of course, we have the structural impediment, but unfortunately, there is no time left for me to touch on the structural long-term issue, so Takita-san's urged me to stop it, and this here I would like to stop it. Thank you very much for listening.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Koide-san, for your very quick presentation. Then the time is rest only 5 minutes, but like to concentrate our agendas very quickly. Then I felt that if we use you know, the lunar calendar, just now the 13th night or the 14th night, just before the 15th night, mean the full moon, then business condition looks very comfortable in such a period. Anyway, so if we point out some risk for such a business condition, what would be the such a risk? I'd like to touch upon each panelist figuring out such a risk for the current very comfortable business conditions one by one. Please, Bill, please, first.
So from my personal perspective, I think I'm pretty comfortable with regard to the U.S. economy, as I mentioned, being in relatively in balance without any true outliers. So I think my risks, I look outside of the United States, and I think it's hard for me to ignore the second largest economy in the world sitting to my right, China. And in part, I like markets, and I like markets that allocate resources, and that is not what is taking place in China. And I just get concerned about an adjustment period that might be necessary when you have less than profitable ventures that need to be readjusted. And then how hard does that affect the U.S. economy? In terms of our exports, we export more to Canada and Mexico. Proximity matters. But after that, China gets the next largest amount of our exports. So it does matter to the U.S. economy.
Right, thank you. So China risk is referred by him. Please, your comment.
So with respect to China, I think the risk is that the two areas that she is likely to target, in my view, are technology and finance, and those have been two of the fastest growing areas inside China. And so I think that could lead to that slowdown that I'm looking for. If I wanted to express two major global risks in general, the first would be the potential advent of a Chinese cryptocurrency, a digital currency backed by the Chinese government. Because in my view, that would give them a 10-year leap on replacing the dollar as the major currency in the world, which I don't see happening for a long time, but that's a good way to move it up really quickly. And the second is if somebody makes a mistake in the Middle East with Mohammed bin Salman trying to consolidate growth there and the potential for a war between Saudi Arabia and Iraq, Iran, or some combination of the two, you know, you're not far. You have relatively tight oil markets now. As Bill was pointing out, you could be back above 100 in a heartbeat.
Thank you, Michel. For Mr. Koide.
Besides the points already two gentlemen already touched upon, maybe I would say the still there is a risk of the banking system in Europe. In panel one, the European real economy is very good, more than expected, and earlier than expected, the ECB is moving toward the exit policy. Right now, the bad debt ratio is around slightly over the 5%, but I guess go down from a much higher level, but still in some countries such as Spain, more than 15%, and Greece and Cyprus is more than 40%, close to 45%, just look unsustainable. So therefore, maybe higher interest rate and higher inflation invite bank system consolidation issue again. And putting aside, let me add one episode to just let our audience understand the urgent risk of the extended leverage in China, Hong Kong. Just the Michael already touched on. When I visited the Hong Kong 1 year after the Lehman crisis, that was September 2009. At that time, the U.S. Interest rate is zero, of course. And as you may know, the Hong Kong dollar and the U.S. dollar are just 101 pegging system. So therefore, if in the future the federal fund rate starts to inch up, automatically the Hong Kong policy rate just go up. And then surprisingly enough, the majority of the mortgage loan provided to their market is short-term float rate. Incredible. So therefore, at that time, a long-term prime rate for the 30-year mortgage in 2009 is only 80 basis points. From that point, the unit price of the first class of the office building in Hong Kong Island soared more than tripled. And the, I asked one of the staff of the FSA in Hong Kong, says, don't you feel scared? Once in the future, the Federal Reserve began to inch up the policy rate. And he said, if in the future, federal fund rate will go up to 1%, for example, our real estate market will be exploded into pieces. Now we have 1.25%. And then lastly, he just made a joke to me, but I personally don't worry too much about that. It is long way from here. So therefore, before the United States will raise the policy rate up to the 1%, I will be transferred to another division. I don't care. This is my episode.
Very interesting hot potato story. Thank you. Then I'd like to have some concluding remarks from Mr. Smithson about such risks.
You've seen our official version of risk, like a geopolitical, financial. But personally, I think that we have at the point where the sea may change. We have been we have enjoyed the tremendous easy money across the region, and then the corporate sector has piled up quite a lot of leverage, and then, like Koide-san was saying, the household have increased quite a lot of leverage in terms of their mortgages, and then many the most mortgages are so-called adjustable mortgages. So if it goes up, the serviceability of the mortgage has become very, very heavy on the household. Of course, the household mortgages are considered to be the prime asset of the financial sector. So the impact, should mortgage market go sour, on the financial sector can be very large. So of course, the Fed will manage that. The transition very, very cautiously and prudently. But if the, you know, one thing I learned that the, you know, 30 years ago at the Harvard Business School is that, you know, in order to survive in the market, I mean, you go out there on a picnic and picking up berries and fruits in the woods, and then once in a while, that bear, the grizzly, comes out and then, you know, eats you. But you don't have to run faster than the bear. You have to run faster than the guy next to you, right? So this makes that entire investment community aware. I mean, like, you know, if there are people are scared about the spook that the bear may come out, they are like very spooky and then look around, and then even without the bear present, they may start to run. Right? So that's my most risky scenario. And in that case, the Fed rate goes up, the term premium goes up, and then credit premium goes up. So let's think about what happens to the local currency denominated long-term bond market, corporate market. So many corporations will have difficulty servicing it. So and then along with the many households defaulting on their mortgages, that's the biggest risk scenario I'm sort of fearful about. So I'm hoping that the Fed will be super cautious in moving, thinking about all these possibilities in mind.
Thank you for the very excellent panelist. And I should say some apologizing for you to cut such a question from our audience, but please raise such a question on the coffee break times and want to have some applause for nice panelists. Thank you very much.
We will start session 4 at 3:35. So we have coffee and tea on the left side of the room, so please enjoy coffee and tea.
I guess Yoshihiro has a...
の資料ここに置いてます。小出さんで、こちらにあの次のPEの質問を置いてますので、でビルと小出さん座っていただいて、PEの3人はもうあちらにね。
Yes, introduce you.